Hey there, folks. Today I'd like to take a casual peek into the Garo equipment prop series of Garo and Zaraba from Bandai. This set is volume 1 in the equip and prop series and was first available around 2005 or 2006. I'm not sure. There are two dates on this packaging, so I'm going to guess maybe 2006. And I don't know how much this set originally cost, but again, based on the packaging, it looks like it may have cost around 3,800 yen at the time, which converts to about 38 US dollars. Now, I got this set in 2014 when I purchased it from Mandarake, which is a Japanese secondhand pop culture web store. And I paid 6,000 yen for this set, which converts to about $60. Now, taking a closer peek at this particular set, Volume 1 in the Equip and Prop series, this is a series of Garo-related figures in where you have both the ability to equip the figure, which is the equip portion of the equipment prop, and also you have a prop or a replica prop from the show, the prop portion of equipment prop. And it's a very interesting line. And you can see here in the packaging, you have what looks like two figures, but really isn't. We have the figure of Koga, the main character on the show here, on the left. And through assembly, you can actually, quote, equip Koga into Garo, which is over here on the right. And Garo translates to Fanged Wolf on the show. And it's pretty cool. You could see that the figure and the parts here. You could see some accessories on there. Very cool. And what you have over here is the prop portion of the set, which is Zaraba, which is the an intelligent item. Certain items have a sentience on the show, and Zaraba is one of those. And he is in the form of a ring, and it's I guess belongs to Koga on the show, which is pretty cool. Now, taking a look at the packaging, this packaging is also interesting. It's not your typical cardboard packaging. It's actually clear plastic packaging, which is actually pretty nice. And you can see some design on the plastic packaging here on the corner. You can see the Garo name going down here. And there is some cardboard as part of the packaging, but it's on the inner portion of the packaging. You can see what is the symbol on the Garo television show there. And you have information down here, Volume 1 Equip and Prop of Garo and Zaraba, or Zaraba. And along the top, you have some more cardboard packaging underneath the plastic there, indicating Garo, the symbol for the show. And you can see this Garo, the series, Garo equip and prop over there. Pretty cool. You can see some more of the design going down here and some of the cardboard liner behind it on that side. You got some more design work on the this side of the packaging. And this design work here with these flowing lines is very similar to the opening of the show. You have to see the opening credits. It's actually kind of neat. And here we have the back of the packaging with the series volume number and the series set name, Garo and Zaraba. And you have some print information here in Japanese. I don't know what that says, unfortunately. But if you're able to read that, that's what is on there. And then you have a picture here of Garo assembled or equipped, as this series indicates. And you have some more pictures of Garo here, and you have pictures of Koga and the accessories that are included. A sword both for Koga and for Garo. And then you have the prop here of Zaruba, and here's the ring, and here is a nice, I guess, display base you can place the ring on. So that's kind of cool. And you got some more print information here in Japanese, as well as here at the bottom on there. Now we'll be right back and have Garo and Zaruba out of the packaging. Okay, we have all of the parts and pieces out of the packaging, and as you can see, there's quite a bit. A lot of it are parts for the Garo figure, and we're gonna go ahead and take a peek at those. But first, let's go ahead and get started with this. And this is basically the packing sheet that's included in this set, and just adjust that there. And we have visual instructions on how to use the various parts and pieces, such as the hand swapping and the part swapping here to transform Koga to Garo, and also how to use the Zaruba ring and display base. And then you have a final picture here of Garo and Zaruba. And you got the equipment prop logo here, and what looks like a Tamashii web logo here. I guess this was an exclusive, web exclusive. I did not know that, so that's kind of cool. And you got the link there and some date information from mid-2000 Project Garo there. Pretty neat. And we're gonna go ahead and take a peek at the prop portion first. And that is the Zaruba ring and display base. And this is actually quite cool. And you could see here, it's very detailed. Now, this is actually made of metal, which is very, very nice. So the replica prop of Zaruba is very cool, and a little bit weighty here, and you can see all the sculpting detail here is very ornate and very, very nice. Now, this is Zaruba on the display base, so it's not just the ring, but the display base as well. The ring is, of course, the face of Zaruba there, and the display base is what you can see are some hands on there, very, very cool, and what looks like a neck area on there. And the ring is loose, it just rests on the base there. You do have to do a little bit of adjustments here and there if you want it to sit properly. A lot of times it'll knock over, but you just do minor adjustments here and there for it to rest properly on the base on there. But still pretty cool. Let me just go ahead and remove the ring, and you can see some more details on the ring there. Very detailed sculpting around the face. You can see on the eye area, the mouth area there, and the ornate head design. Very cool on there. And on the ring itself, you can see all the sculpting design. They're very, very nice. The inner portion of the ring there. Now, the ring is sculpted into, I guess, a medium-sized ring. I have smaller hands, so when I put it on my hand, it sits a bit loose on there. It does slip in and out. But for larger hands, I guess it'll be a decent fit, and then, or even larger hands, it may be a tight fit. But I would say it's about a medium size. I don't know what ring sizes, the numbers mean on ring sizes, so I couldn't tell you. But I would say it's about medium sized on there, and it's very cool. I really like this prop portion. Now, taking a look at some more details of the base, you can see all the sculpting. This is where the ring sits. You slip it over this portion here, what looks like the neck area. You can see this is the back of the neck. Very cool. Got some stocks here to go around the ring, and I guess this would be the neck area Pretty cool. And of course you have some crossed arms sculpted here at the very bottom of the base. Very, very neat. Very detailed and just quite cool. And on the bottom here you have some copyright information that says 2005 Project Garo. Some numbering there. I don't know what that means. And then Bandai made in China. So that's a bit weighty for a metallic piece, and just really cool. One of the main reasons why I got this particular Garo set is for the props. It's really nice for display. Or if you want to do a cosplay or anything like that, you have a ring to go with your outfit. But next thing we're going to go ahead and take a look at is the Koga figure. And he's right about here. Now, this is a pretty interesting figure, and it has a lot of detail as well. And this figure is the sized, I would think, similar to the SIC line. It seems like there's a lot of design elements that are similar to the SIC design. And I think these Garo Equip and Prop Series sets are from the same sculptor. It looks very similar. I think it's Takeya who's the sculptor. I could be wrong. I'm not sure if that's correct in the name. But it looks very similar, and it's sized similar as well. This particular figure stands about 6.5 inches to almost 7 inches tall. And scales well with other SIC figures. This particular Koga figure is smaller than your typical SIC figure, but I think it's still in the same scale, which is pretty interesting. And you can see a lot of detail into this figure, which is very, very cool. Let me just adjust the brightness there. And you could see the very detailed sculpt of the head, especially with the hair there. Very, very cool. And the face has some nice sculpting, and there's some paint detail on the skin. I don't know if it's called a blush effect, but the cheeks are a little reddish, slightly reddish compared to the rest of the skin tone there, which is pretty cool. It's kind of hard to see on the video, but it's there. I think it's just the lighting on my setup here. But very detailed head sculpt. I like it a lot, actually. And you can see there's multiple applications of paint on there as well. Primarily browns in there, dark browns and medium browns there. But it adds a lot of definition to the sculpt on there and makes it look alive, you could say. And very, very cool. And moving down here, this is basically Koga in his suit without his coat on here. And pretty neat. You got some sculpting detail here on his torso, on his, I guess, upper torso suit, which is kind of cool. I don't know if it was originally silver on the show. I think it's maybe a little bit duller. In the show, and it's here it's painted vibrant silver, which makes it stand out quite a bit. I remember seeing some episodes where it wasn't as bright as it is on the figure, but it's still pretty cool. And it is a metallic silver that's painted on that torso there, and it's very, very cool. And then you can see the rest of the suit here, got lots of sculpting detail with the folds in the leather or cloth. Very cool here on the back as well. And then you got some mesh type of armor going on down the sides, which is cool. And it's painted, I guess, a greenish blue hue on there. And it's actually kind of neat on there. And down here, you got the pants that he wears with a belt buckle there. A little bit of paint slop on there, but not that bad. On there, and you got more of that mesh design going down the side on there. Even the back of his pants have pockets sculpted onto it. Pretty cool. Even the straps on the belt area of the pants is pretty nice. And more sculpting detail on the legs, with not as many folds as on the upper torso, like on the arms here, but it's pretty cool. Still on the legs, there are a few near the crotch areas, which is kind of cool. And but there are more folds and sculpting going on the lower leg. And his pair of pants has a what look like a knee guards or padding there, which is pretty interesting. And he has very simple shoes, but there is a bit of sculpting going on there, and very flat with a heel on the bottom of the feet. So pretty neat. And this figure does have articulation, but I don't think the main purpose of this figure is a dynamic posability, because it is rather limited on the range of motion on the articulation points. And this figure really is not the highlight of the set. It's more of a like a bonus type almost type of thing. And but it's still cool that they included as much articulation as there is. And we're gonna go ahead and go over that right now. The head, there is a ball joint at the neck that allows the head to move left and right slightly, tilt. Oops, popped it out. You can see the ball joint there. There, and the socket in there. And just pop it back in, and you can see that it moves up and down slightly, not as much to the side. And that's not really the main purpose for the head, is really to equip it with Garo, and we'll show that in a little bit. But there is limited movement for the head. The arms can go all the way around at the shoulder, and can move in and out ever so slightly, not that much. And it does rotate forward and back as well. And those arms are really meant to pop off when you equip Garo. There is a single joint at the elbow. A hinge joint allows you to bend the arm this much forward, this much straight. There are ball joints at the hands that allow you to rotate the hand around the wrist, all the way around, in and out slightly, even side to side. And these are meant to be popped out if you want to equip a sword wielding hand on there. There is upper torso articulation, very limited, allows you to bend the figure slightly forward, slightly back, and slightly around, but not that much. It's very limited there, and even tilts side to side. There is a waist articulation joint that allows you to turn the torso around, but not too much. If you turn it around too much, it will pop off at the waist, and that's meant for equipping Garo. And it does tilt side to side as well. So with a combination of the upper and mid torso there, you can get some okay posability, but not that much. The legs at the hips have ball socketed articulation points, just like the shoulders here. The leg can go up about that much, not that far, down, and not even backwards due to the sculpt on the hip there. And the figure can move the leg at the hip that far outwards. And it looks like you can rotate it ever so slightly forward and back at the hip as well. There is single joints at the knees, allows you to bend the leg that far back and this far forward. And there are ball socket joints at the ankles that allow you to bend the foot ever so slightly downwards and slightly upwards. And around a little bit, but the cuff of the pants limits the movement there. And there is slight ankle pivot just due to the articulation of the ball socket joints. So as you can see, this is rather limiting on posability, but again, the highlight of the set is really the Garo and not the Koga figure. But it's still nice that they included the Koga figure at to go with Garl. Not many sets have a figure of the unequipped Garl, so it's kind of a neat bonus to have for this set. Now we're going to go ahead and take a look at the parts for Garl, and it's pretty cool. Before we go ahead and equip Koga into Garl, and we'll just briefly look at all the individual parts first, and we'll start out with some of the legs. And it's very well detailed in the sculpt. You can see the leg here, the articulation point for the ball socket, hinge joint for the knee, and ball socket for the ankle. But the details on here is very cool. The gold on here is not as vibrant as on the show. On the show, it's very metallic and very reflective on here. But this one is made of plastic. The parts are made of plastic and have a gold paint application on there. So it's still pretty good, but not as glossy and reflective as on the show. But it's still a very nice application of gold paint. You can see on here on the scale portions of the armor. And it's very, very cool. And we'll go over more detail as we put this Garo figure together. But just pretty neat for the pair of legs here. Now the torso armor is painted in a similar color, but the material used is quite different. While this was a harder plastic here on the leg, the torso is made of a very soft, pliable, rubberized material. And it's meant to fit over the torso of the Koga figure. It's made of this material to accommodate the outfitting of the Garo figure. And you can see, even with the soft material here, there's a lot of detail sculpted onto here. It's very nice. And a lot of paint detail as well. And it's applied very nicely on there. And we have the head of Garo here. Very nicely sculpted on here, made of a harder plastic. And this is actually two pieces here. You have the neck portion here and the head portion. But I've attached the two pieces together already because it's quite tight in the fit in the neck. And I had a difficult time attaching the neck to the head. So I don't want to actually remove it now. But there is a ball socketed joint at the top of the neck there. So it adds additional posability in addition to the base of the neck. So pretty cool on there. And you can see some sculpted and painted detail, silver here on the ears and along the middle of the helmet there. Pretty nice on there. And paint detail on the teeth in silver. And the rest in gold and black. So very nicely detailed head. Oops. Next we have some arms on here. Very cool. And you can see multiple paint details. In addition to the gold, they have that bluish, grayish, or greenish paint application for that chain mail underneath all of this plate mail. And then you have some silver painted along the arms as well. And you can see the articulation points, ball sockets. Lots of ball socketed joints in this figure. And this one's a double ball socket. They have a ball joint here to attach to the shoulder. And there's a ball joint within the arm. So kind of neat to have two points of articulation at the shoulder there. So you got some detail on the hands here. Pretty cool. Next thing I'll take a look at is the belt area. Pretty neat. This here in the center is actually made of a separate piece. The belt itself is a little bit harder plastic. You can see some details here. But this middle piece here is a separate piece. You can see on the other side where it's attached on there. And it's got some nice sculpting design in the very center here with the triangle. I think that's translucent plastic with red underneath it. So it emits a dark almost blood red type of hue to it, which is actually kind of cool. And then you have some painted detail also as well. Nice belt. And these three pieces here are the clasps for the cloak or cape. These go on either side of the torso armor here, which is neat. These are made of plastic, and you can see the peg joints there with some paint detail and sculpting detail there. And this center one here is made of metal, and you can see it attaches to the middle of the back there. And very cool that this one's made of metal. I think it's the security in the cape into place when you attach it, and has similar paint and sculpting detail as the other two clasps. So that's kind of cool. And we'll take a look at this here. This is the cape. Very interesting, made of very pliable rubberized material, almost semi-translucent, as you can see at the ends of the cape. You can see my fingers slightly through there. Yeah, so it's pretty neat, and it's got some sculpting detail. You can see on this side some what look like cracks on there on the cape. So I'm gonna guess this is sort of a leather-like cape, which is very neat. You got some paint detail on the middle area here, and also on the tips of the cape, painted in gold. So, which is kind of cool. And when you flip this over, you got some really nice sculpting going underneath this cape here, but it's not painted. Well, other than the greenish hue on here. A dark greenish hue, but you can see the sculpting detail on either side of the inner portion of the cape, which is very, very cool. I like that. And then you got this sculpting going on in the middle, which is pretty cool. And you got the three holes here where you clasp it onto the back of the figure there, so pretty neat. And we have some extra hands to go with this figure. We have a pair of closed fists on this set here, and lots of detail on that. You have a gripping hand here, which is pretty neat. And you have here a alternate hand for the Koga figure that allows you to have him grip the sword on there. And take a look at this here. This is the sword for Koga, which is pretty cool, made of hard plastic. On the scabbard here, and you got the handle for the sword, and nice details on that. Very, very cool. And unsheath the sword, you can see it's a very flat blade, but nicely detailed, nicely painted, nicely sculpted on there. And this, the blade itself is bendable. You can see how I bend it here and there. So if you bend it too much, it may get warped on there, so you just have to be careful with that. I like keeping it in the scabbard here, which is pretty cool. Now the hand that wields the scabbard for Koga is very tight fitting, and I've had a difficult time trying to put it on to the gripping the blade, I should say. And I'm gonna do that later, because once I have this on the blade, it's going to be very hard to remove, so I'm not going to do that now. But one thing to note is that there is no additional or corresponding left hand. This is a right hand here. There is no corresponding right hand to grip the scabbard, which is unfortunate. It would have been nice to have an additional hand to grip the scabbard and one to grip the blade, but it's not included with the Koga figure. But that's something you just have to deal with. The last thing we have here for accessory is the blade for Garo, which is pretty cool. Now, the blade is in a sheath here, and it's very, very cool. I got some nice detail here going on. You can see the scabbard here with some detail on the sculpt and paint. Very, very cool. And the scabbard is made of plastic, hard plastic here, but the blade itself is made of metal. But I just want to show off that there's even paint detail here on the tips with some green on there. I don't know if those are gems or not, but very cool. You got the triangle here on the handle of the blade, and the entire blade is made of metal, even the handle, the hilt on here, and the pommel on there. But very cool detail sculpting wise here. You got paint in red here and also in the triangle area, excuse me. And when you unsheath the sword here, you can see the blade is very nicely detailed. There's a paint application of what looks like black on here, and it's very, very cool. And then you have some paint detail in white, some ornate designs there. Very, very nice. I really like that. And then you have sculpting detail. I don't know if that's a wolf's head or not, but then you have this line of gold, wavy line of gold, which is actually sculpted into the blade there. You have to see it in person to really look at the attention to detail on this blade. It's actually very, very cool on there, especially this line of gold here that's sculpted there. Very, very cool on there. I really like this piece here, and again, made of metal, and very nice, and it has a nice tight fit in the scabbard here. Now next we're gonna go ahead and outfit Koga and transform him into Garo. Alrighty, we're gonna go ahead and transform Koga into Garo, and we're gonna start off with the Koga figure here. And in order to equip Koga into Garo, the only parts you need to use from the Koga figure is the upper, mid, and lower torso. The arms and legs and head aren't used during the equipping of Koga into Garo. And what we're going to do is pop off the head here, and pop off the arms as well. You can see they are removable, and you can see the ball joint there and the socket. And pop off the other arm here, and I'm transforming this or equipping this figure for the very first time, so I don't know how tight these joints are going to be in removing it from the figure, but it looks like on the legs you might have to twist there, and you can see the ball joint for the hip and the leg for Koga there. And we're going to do the same with the other leg. Just pop that off. And I believe you also pop off the mid torso from the waist, or from the lower torso, in order to equip the belt portion there. And you can see there's a little bit of dust. Or it's, I think it's some of the plastic material in the socket joint area that seems to come loose when you pop the joints off. So it looks like if you do this repeatedly that the joints may become looser over time, so you might want to be careful about equipping or dequipping the figures. You may want to just limit yourself and the number of times you wish to equip it. But we'll start off with the lower torso here, and I believe you're supposed to slip the belt area over here, which is interesting. And then let's go ahead and pop on the legs here first. Might be a little bit easier, and I might have to do this off screen. Okie doke, we've got the Garo legs onto the Koga lower torso here. And I gotta say, putting the legs on, at least for the first time, is very difficult to do. And I actually had to stop the video and restart the video after I had put the legs back onto this torso. It's just very, very tight. It may get easier over time, but for the first time, it was really super difficult to put the legs on. And now we're going to go ahead and slip the waist armor and groin armor there on top of the lower torso there. And you can see there's a bit of a gap, and that's normal. on there. And then what we're going to go ahead and do is pop the rest of the torso back onto the figure. Or maybe we should actually apply the arms first. That may be easier, won't be as unwieldy. And hopefully popping the arms on here won't be as difficult. And this here is the left arm. And we'll see if we can pop it into the joint. There we go. That wasn't too bad. We got that one on there. And you can see the double ball joint here. And hopefully this one will be easier as well. That wasn't too bad. And now we have the arms of Garo onto the Koga torso. And then what we'll do is pop the torso into the lower torso here. Let me just spread the legs open here, make it easier to grip. There we go. It doesn't make a popping sound when it gets secured into place. So you just have to feel to see if the torso locks into place into the joints. So we've got the torso here now in place. And what we're going to do is slip on the torso, upper torso armor. And as I mentioned earlier, this is a soft, pliable piece of plastic. And if you notice over here, there are pegs on either side, and they are to peg into the sides of the armor. So what you do is you basically slip this on top and fasten the joints, the peg joints on there. So you slip it on here. You may want to raise the arms a little bit so you have some better view of what how to squeeze that in. And that just fits in real nice. And we'll pop this one here into place. This one to fit in as easily as the other one. Here, let me do this off screen too. There we go. And this one doesn't want to close in completely as the other one, but there we go. We've got the most of the armor in place now. And what we have here is the head. With the torso armor, we're just going to go ahead and pop the head in there. And all we have left are the clasps that go into the back of the figure. Now, you can equip Garo with or without the cape. Without the cape, you just simply peg these into place. Here, it doesn't seem to want to fit as well. It's a very tight fit there. If you don't want to have the cape, you can place the armor in there. Let me find the middle one here. And I believe this only fits in this one direction here. That doesn't want to go in all the way. There we go. That fits in a little bit better. And then we have this here. So if you don't want to have a caped Garo figure, you can place those pieces on into place, and it looks all right. But for this video, we're going to go ahead and attach the cape on there. So we'll take these off again. And you'll notice that the cape has those loops that just go over the peg holes. So you want to fit that in nicely there. And attach the clasps. At least that's what I'm calling them. Whether they have a different name or not, I'm not sure. So let's go ahead and fit that one over. It's there. That fits nicely. And no difficulty in applying that. And we're going to go ahead and attach this middle piece here. Hopefully I'm fitting this in the correct direction here. And that fits nicely there. So that's pretty cool. And we basically have Garo outfitted now, or equipped, I should say, since this is the prop and equip line. And that's a pretty neat figure. Now, I don't have Koga to do a size comparison, but I would say he's about half a head to a full head shorter than Garo. But we're going to do a size comparison with a similar line, the SIC line. And I'm going to go ahead and get an SIC figure. And I have Kuga here, at least Rising Form Kuga. And standing them next to each other, you can see they are in similar heights on there. So it's not too bad and pretty much almost compatible. And that's kind of cool. And let me just go ahead and get this guy out of the way, and we'll take a closer peek into Garo. And this is a really decent figure, and looks pretty cool. Now, again, I have to mention that the gold that's applied onto this figure is mostly on plastic, so you're not going to get the shining, reflective armor like as shown on the show. But it's still very nicely done. The level of application of paint onto the plastic figure is actually pretty decent. It's not bad at all. And it's very nice. And you could see all the intricate detail on the figure overall. And it's actually pretty cool on here. And I'm not sure if I have these backwards or not, but I'm going to have to refer to the parts listing again. But if it's backwards, I apologize. But it looks about right. And just really nice detail. I like the detail overall. And it's pretty cool on there. And you can see all the details in the figure. Very ornate in design. Very, very cool on here. Now, as far as articulation for this figure, the head, let's see, can go side to side, but the chin does run into the armor a little bit. But if I close the jaw, maybe it might turn a little bit more. It does go around, does go up and down here with the base of the neck. At the top of the neck, there's also additional articulation on the head. And the jaw does open and close, so that's kind of cool. Now, the arms at the shoulders can go up about that far around and this far back, but there is this cape and collar or shoulder armor here that does impede the articulation of the arm going around. So that's unfortunate, but that's just part of the armor, you could say. And you're not really expecting to do these really super dynamic poses with the figure. It's an armored figure though. And the arm does go out about that far out to the side and inwards. And there is a bicep swivel, allows you to turn the arm all the way around. So that's nice, so you can get some more decent inward arm movement there. Now there is a hinge at the elbow, allows you to bend the arm about that far in, straighten out about that much. And I believe there's a swivel at the lower elbow. So you can turn the lower arm all the way around. There's a ball socket joint at the wrist, so you can turn that hand all the way around. You can slightly go in and out and side to side as well. And there is the mid-torso articulation joint, so you can turn the figure side to side around a little bit, but the armor does impede the articulation a bit and does bend downwards slightly and back a bit, so that's not too bad. There is that waist articulation, but it's not really able to be used that much because of the waist armor in the way. It's hard to access that joint, But if you get a good grip, you can do it slightly, so it's not too bad. Now, there are ball socket joints at the hips, allows the leg to go up about that much, down, and doesn't go back due to the sculpt. It does go out to the side, even with the armor, so you have about that much movement out to the side. And there is a swivel joint at the top of the thigh, so you can turn the leg around, but not completely around, but in most positions there, so you can get some decent posing there. There are two hinges at the knees, but it only allows you to bend the knee that far back, which is unfortunate due to this knee armor here, the silver part. And it allows you to straighten out the leg that much. There is a ball joint under the knee, so you can turn it slightly and go side to side slightly on there. Now, the ankles have a very decent ball joint, or ball socket joint, I believe. So you can put the foot forward about that much, bend it down about that much, and it looks like it's double ball socket joints, one at the lower leg and one at the foot. So that's kind of cool. And you can turn the foot all the way around, as well as some ankle pivot, some decent ankle pivot, as you can see here. So that's kind of cool. So overall, a really decent Garo figure once you have it equipped. Does have limits on the articulation just due to the nature of the armor on there, but still pretty decent for posing, and just really excellent sculpt on there. A really nice attention to detail on here. It's just really, really cool. And of course, you have the cool items of the prop portion of the equipment prop, like the ring for Zaroba there, and just very, very neat. I really like the prop portion of that. And of course, you have the bonus figure of Koga on here, but of course, he's in pieces now that he's equipped as Garo. So, but a really decent set, a set that I plan to continue collecting, even though there were only about six sets produced. Six different types of sets produced. I plan to see if I can get a hold of the other ones, even though they are no longer in production. But a very decent series to start off with my Garo collection. This is my casual peek into the Garo Equip and Prop Garo and Zaroba Set Volume 1. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys next time. Thank you.